So here's my solution. I take out all the input parameters, and the very first thing is I set the dimension of the matrix and the vector. The length of the path, plus the number of landmarks, times 2, because I'm modeling x and y for each of those in the same data structures. I then create a matrix for omega and a vector for xi, give it the appropriate dimensions, and subsequently, I introduce the constraint that the initial positions have to be world size over 2, with a strength value of 1. It turns out this has no bearing on the final solutions, because it's the only absolute constraint. But you can see I add 1 over here in the main diagonal, 1 for x and 1 for y, and I now add the same over here. It's important to understand how I set up the data structure. There's our positions. Let me just for a second call them S. And there's our landmarks. Each of those have an x component and a y component. So what I'm doing is I'm taking this matrix and I'm setting it up not by a matrix of path length plus number of landmarks, but each of those becomes a 2x2 matrix where I explicitly retain the x and the y value. So the dimension here is 2 times n, the path length, plus number landmarks. And the 2 is the result of modeling x and y, x, y, x, y, x, y. That's really important for my solution. You might have done this differently. You might have said, I'm going to build one matrix for x and one matrix for y. And then each of those becomes just a single value, which is closer to the way we discussed it in class. That's fine in this case. In general, it has disadvantages in that it cannot correlate x and y's. So for a real robot that has real rotations, this doesn't work. My solution is better, but for this specific example, this would have been perfectly fine. Coming back to my example, I now process the data. I go through all the data items, and my path index is now the data item times 2, which is the XY thing. I extract my measurements from the data, my motion from the data, using this command over here. And then I go through all the measurements, of which there might be multiple ones. I find the index in my matrix of the measurement, which is the path plus the measurement index, times 2 because you have x and y's again. And then the next routine just implements the simple addition with the measurement noise as the inverse weighting factor. So it adds 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1 to the corresponding elements in the submatrix. And in the vector, it adds the measurement, all divided by the strength of the noise variable. If you look at this carefully, it'll take a minute to digest it. I'm obviously using the auxiliary variable b to account for the fact that there's x and y. So b goes from 0 to 1. And these are all the combinations. You have to stare at them to make sure they're all correct. But I can promise you they're actually all correct. Motion is handled very much the same way. I extract the motion command. I add among the main diagonal between the two variables that are being tied together, a plus 1. Then I add and the off-diagonal elements, minus 1s. Again, you have to stare at this very carefully to see they're all correct. And then I add the motion itself to the vector xi. That's what I had to implement. I then solve as before and return the solution. And that's exactly what's being printed out down here. I have to say, if you got this correct, I'm mightily impressed. You understood a lot about mapping, and you solved a really hard programming problem. I'm responding to some of you online who ask for challenging programming problems. This is a challenging piece of code to write. It took myself a number of hours to write, and I'd be wonderful if you got it right.